Well, let's switch over to talk about eggs, and I'm going to ask you some of the same questions and also to draw some contrast. You've already been doing that to some extent. So the first is just to say, tell us about the kind of women who become egg donors.
So again, in my interviews with egg donors, I found sort of two groups of women. So the younger college students who are interested in being donors to make money in order to pay for their education. There was also a not insignificant number of young mothers who were in their late 20s. They'd had children of their own. They might be staying at home. And being an egg donor allowed them to contribute to somebody else, having the joy that they had experienced with their own children, as well as to make some money without having to work a 9-to-5 job.
And what are the criteria for being an egg donor? You kind of suggested earlier that they're not quite as stringent as being a sperm donor.
Like sperm donors, egg donors are providing a bodily substance, and so they're subject to some of the same screening mechanisms. So they have to provide the 3 generations of family health history. They're doing genetic testing, they're doing contagious disease testing, they're doing blood testing. But the differences, in addition to the height and education requirement that I talked about before, one of the expectations that isn't really written down anywhere is that women donate for the right reasons. And so for women who call an egg agency and say, well, I'm really interested in laying my eggs for some cash. That's a quote from one of the people I interviewed. Those women would not be allowed to continue because they're not doing it for the right reasons. And again, we have these expectations of femininity where women are going to be helpful, sort of naturally caring, wanting to help people have children that are suffusing the expectations for donors in this area. So those motivational expectations really exist for egg donors and they don't at all for sperm donors.
So it sounds like there's a real gender difference between sperm donation as employment, make some quick cash, egg donation as help build a family, do it for the right reasons, very deontological. Is that kind of what you found in your research?
Yes, absolutely. And it's not only something that affects how the egg agencies and sperm banks operate. I mean, it's how they're recruiting people, it's how they're screening them. It then affects the donors' experiences. So women walk away from egg donation with this narrative of, I helped somebody and I made $5,000 or $10,000. And so women can feel good about what they've done and helped make this contribution. And in contrast, the sperm donors I interviewed felt as if they had been milked for a resource they could provide. They felt a little bit alienated and objectified as sperm donors. And so that's the last thing I expected, having started this research, you know, interested in these gender comparisons, to walk away from this research thinking, wow, you know, sperm donors get kind of a bum deal. They too are helping people create families. They too are making a huge difference, but nobody's writing them thank you notes or giving them gifts or telling them how wonderful they are.
And it's interesting because it's a little bit of a flip of the typical gender narrative, right, and that the men are being treated as a piece of meat, as kind of objects, rather than partners, whereas the women seem to have, on the one hand, it flips the gender narrative, on the other, I guess it reiterates a gender narrative about caregiver and warmth and altruism versus work, right?
Exactly.
Say a little bit more about the payment and the recruitment. So you'll hear in many courses on bioethics, they'll show you an ad run in the Harvard Crimson or another newspaper at a college campus saying, this tall, this SAT score, this ethnicity, and then promising a very high amount of money, it would seem, for egg donation. Is that the way it typically works? How are they paid? How are they recruited?
So these advertisements that you're mentioning really get a lot of attention, but the standard issue first-time egg donor who's going through an agency can expect to make $5,000 or $10,000 for that donation. So this is something that is changing right now. So there was just a lawsuit brought by egg donors against the American Society for Reproductive Medicine for price fixing, for setting these expectations for what a good amount of money is for egg donation. So this will be interesting to see as we move forward in the next couple years how that affects the prices of egg donation.
So this case was settled actually. It was an antitrust case, and the solution was to remove the recommendation from the American Society for Reproductive Medicine to pay between $5,000 and $10,000. So as you say now, without this recommendation in place, it's possible prices in the market will fluctuate or change. But the typical egg donor, you say the first time through, can expect in the US to make between $5,000 and $10,000.
That's right.
And where do egg brokers, and you've used that term, and maybe we should ask about that, to use the term brokers or agencies with eggs, which we typically don't use that term for sperm. What are these entities and how do they recruit women? How do they find women?
So this, again, is an interesting historically infused difference in the language that's used. So the idea that there are banks of sperm and sperm donors are paid. Kara Swanson has written a really interesting book about the history of that bank language. And in contrast, egg agencies really grew out of fertility agencies, the idea of adoption agencies. And so that language of agency versus bank, again, sociologically is coming from the industry. And I think that we need to pay attention to it. And egg agencies think of themselves as matching recipients and donors in the same way that adoption agencies match recipients and donors. Several egg agencies also grew out of surrogacy firms originally. And so there's sort of a historical timeline through which these technologies emerged and built on each other or didn't. The thing that's interesting to me is that when egg donation started, they didn't look to sperm donation as a model. They looked to surrogacy or they looked to adoption. And again, I think that's because we think of eggs and sperm as different kinds of bodily goods.
And that's interesting because, you know, the market too has supply meet demand, but in a very impersonal sort of way, whereas the agency seems to be a much more artisanal kind of way of matching people.
Right. Well, and that ties in also with the technology itself. So egg donors still typically do provide fresh donations. And so in egg agencies, you're matching one woman with one recipient. They're cycling together in order for the egg donor to produce eggs right at the time the recipient is ready to receive them. And that's very different from the logistics of sperm banks, where the donor's coming in and producing a bunch of samples, which then get frozen and then sold to a lot of different clients over time. And so it still is a one-to-one relationship for the most part in egg donation, although that too is changing. As egg freezing becomes possible, people have now started up egg banks. And I think that technological shift is going to be interesting to follow to see if egg banks start looking more like sperm banks.
And one of the questions will be whether the current gendered setup of the work follows from gender stereotypes as it follow from the technology, right? We have in some ways a bit of a natural experiment on
Precisely.
This question.
Yeah, there will be a dissertation to be written there, yes.
How many egg donations does a typical egg donor do? So you've told us sperm donation is kind of a relatively middle or long-term service, employment, regular thing. I take it egg donation works very differently.
Well, again here, I don't have any statistics to offer you because we don't have any way of knowing how many egg donors there are, how often they donate, how many children are born. Egg agencies typically limit women to 5 or 6 cycles because they are concerned about the long-term effects of young women undergoing fertility medications in order to produce eggs for the recipient. However, they've really pulled that number out of the sky. We have 0 longitudinal studies about the long-term effects of women who undergo egg production, either to be a donor or for their own in vitro fertilization cycles, or now for those who are freezing their eggs for later. And I think this is an absolutely crucial point about this market. And one of the things that I think is the biggest scandal about this market is that we have been doing IVF since 1978. There has been plenty of time to run those studies. And we have some retrospective data asking women who later develop problems, were you an egg donor? Did you do IVF? But we haven't tracked women over time, which is the gold standard of medical studies. So I actually think that women who undergo egg donation, women who choose to be egg donors, can't actually give informed consent because we don't have the risk information to give them. And I think it's a really important thing to think about, especially as we hear stories about egg freezing be this technological solution to women's biological clock. These are risky medical interventions that we don't actually know all the risks of.
One thing that's interesting here is separate IVF, right? Going through all this to produce your own offspring versus what you might think of as a medical procedure. Okay, there are risks, but there's also benefits. You'll have a child. Versus doing this with egg freezing, where it's about a potential future use you may never need, versus doing it for third-party donation, where you are subjecting yourself to these unknown risks for the benefit of another person and for financial benefit to yourself, and whether we should think about those categories differently.
Right. Well, and I think we have an ethic and a law in this country that women have reproductive choice, they have reproductive agency. So this is not an area that I would say there should be a governmental decision about who should be allowed to do these things or not. However, I think that we need to have a much more direct conversation about what we know and what we don't know about the risks of reproductive technology.
And here, the risk profile is radically different on the egg side than the sperm side,
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely, yes. So this is one of the questions that I always get about this study is, can you really compare sperm donors with egg donors? And certainly, sperm donors are going in, they're masturbating in a small room, they're handing that sample over to a lab tech. They don't really encounter any direct physical risks of that procedure, in contrast to egg donors who are taking on these unknown medical risks and injecting their bodies with fertility medications and going through outpatient surgery, all of which does carry risk. At the same time, I think that, you know, if taking those biological, technological differences into account, we can still look at the language around these different markets and see the expectations that are placed on the donors. So just a thought experiment, we could think of sperm donation as a gift from one man to another, in which men are making this huge difference in helping people have families. It's technologically possible to pair one egg donor with a number of different recipients who are cycling at the same time, but that's not how we've organized those markets. And so the gender differences that we see across egg donation and sperm donation really aren't reducible to technology or biology. Absolutely, we have to take biological differences into account, but they don't provide an explanation for why these markets look different.
Now, one thing that's interesting is the law and regulation of these areas tends to treat the two more symmetrical. As you've said several times, very little law on reproductive technology in the United States. One of the things that makes us an outlier, but also a market for inbound medical tourism. But what law we do have, for the most part, for example, allowing or forbidding compensation, treats the two markets symmetrically. But I hear from you that there's actually big differences in the markets that might have a role in how we ought to think about regulating them. Is that kind of right?
Well, you know, this is a point at which maybe I differ from the legal scholars in the room on reproductive technology. So I think that when people hear about these markets or they hear that we don't know about egg donors and sperm donors, one of the things I think it's really important for us to have is some basic data about the size of this market, how many people are participating, what are their experiences. I am much more reluctant to get involved in the business of regulating this market. And that's because I think about the really long and terrible history of government involvement in reproductive decision making. And I think that we have to proceed extremely cautiously. We don't have a good history of this. Nobody has a good history of government regulations of reproduction. And as in France, you can actually write discrimination into the regulations whenever you think about sort of using democratic processes to do that. So it's one of the places where I have not come to a firm position on this. Do we need more data? Yes. Do I want to go out and start regulating these? I get much more nervous when we talk about that.
Fair enough.